Good evening, everyone. The board wants to welcome all of you to tonight's Board of Ed meeting being held in the town chambers. The date is Tuesday, February 14th, 2017, and happy Valentine's Day to everyone. I want to remind you that this meeting is being recorded, and please turn off all cell phones. Ellie, please do our roll call.
Good evening, everyone. Mr. Cassio?
Present.
Mrs. Fitzpatrick?
Present.
Mr. Forrest?
Present.
Mr. Hill?
Here.
Ms. Moon?
Here.
Mrs. Paradise?
Present.
Mrs. Vazel?
Present.
Vice Chairperson Mr. Morris?
Here.
Chairperson Mrs. Granato?
Present.
And Wethersfield High School Student Representative Mr. Jack Breton?
Present.
All present.
Great, thank you. I would like Logan and Roy Granfield to come on up front and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thanks, Rory. Thanks, Logan. Thanks, Mom and Dad. Thank you. Mr. Emmett, I do always look forward to our student recognition and staff recognition. Do we have any tonight?
We do, actually, Mrs. Granato. Good evening, everyone. I oftentimes will get emails with updates regarding what our students are up to and what's going on. And on Sunday, February 5th at 7:28 p.m., I received an email mentioning something that our own board representative, Mr. Jack Breton, participated in and won first place in. That would be the Brain Bee competition at Trinity College. So, Jack, could you tell us a little bit about this?
So it's a national neuroscience competition. And the one I competed in was the regional level. And now I will go to the national level in University of Maryland in March.
Outstanding. Well done. And I'd also, this evening, I see them in the back, certainly like to give a shout-out to our Wethersfield Studies students, along with teacher Cheryl Riba. Thank you for being here this evening. Okay.
Okay. All set?
Yes.
Congratulations, Jack. That's great. Next on tonight's agenda is the approval of the minutes of the regular Board of Ed meeting on January 10th, 2017. Are there any corrections?
Okay. Move to accept.
And second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Those minutes are approved. And also, we're looking to approve the minutes of the special Board of Ed meeting on January 28th, 2017. Are there any corrections?
Move to accept.
Second.
A second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Those minutes are approved. Okay, is there anyone wishing to make a public comment? Please come on up to the podium and state your name and address. And may I remind you that we do have a 5-minute limit.
Donna Messenger, 87 Clover Crest Road. I'm here. I just wanted to take the time today, because it's Valentine's Day, to honor a teacher that I thought was exceptional. Her name is Mrs. Susan Breeny. She had been my daughter's ESL tutor, and she did just an exceptional job. Her Lextile score, my daughter's, went up 379 points in that year. And my daughter started with the concept that she's going to be a tough teacher because her prior teacher told her she's serious and tough and really hesitant to be with her. And she went in there and she realized she cared. She realized that the homework that she was offering that the other teacher would never give really helped her. And by the end of the year, she loved Mrs. Breeny. And she was really proud of the fact that, you know, she had advanced herself in English. No child in ESL wants to not know English. They want to fit in. They want to do better. And so I just thought it was, like, important for you to know, because Mrs. Greeny has left the system. And, you know, what had happened is she was in eighth grade, and then she was transferred to the high school. She had, they had implemented a new curriculum in mid-year, and that curriculum, she was telling the administrator the kids weren't receptive to. You know, maybe it needed tweaking. It needed her input, because she was the one teaching the children, and she was told, you know, either do this exactly the way we're told, or, you know, or leave. So she followed what she was told to do, and what happened is she had a great teaching technique that really helped my daughter with her reading, and that's why the Lextile was going up. And as soon as the new curriculum was implemented, her Lextile stopped. You could literally see the numbers. For months, it stopped. And so Mrs. Breeny, what she did was exceptional. She figured out that during study hall, she could help my daughter. And so she did the curriculum, as was told, without, you know, she couldn't have any input as a ESL tutor, even though she had great experience in the middle school. And so she spent study hall doing the technique, and my daughter's Lextile started going up again to the end of the year. And then she got transferred. I was surprised, because I thought she would be there in middle school. She got transferred to the high school, and then months later, she left the system. And, you know, I just wish I could have said goodbye or something, because I never anticipated that. And I just think she was exceptional. And I think we should honor exceptional teachers. We should recognize them and hopefully try to retain them. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Okay, Mr. Emmett, do you have any communications to share?
I do. Thank you, Mrs. Granato. Good evening, everyone, and happy Valentine's Day. I am very pleased to report that we received a letter from the New England Association of Schools and Colleges, the Commission on Public Schools, the Committee on Public Secondary Schools at its January 22nd, 23rd, 2017 meeting, reviewed the special progress report Wethersfield High School provided, continued the school's accreditation, and removed the school from warning for the standard on community resources for learning. The committee was pleased to learn of the completion of the building project and the full occupancy of the building. The school's accreditation status will be reviewed when it considers the evaluation report resulting from the 2021 on-site visit. School officials are reminded of the responsibility to keep the committee apprised of any substantive changes in the school prior to the decennial evaluation. For your convenience, we've enclosed a copy of the change policy as well. Please notify the committee office immediately of any changes in the names of principal or superintendent, along with the corresponding email addresses, by submitting the information to NEASC. So very pleased to report that we are no longer in the warning status for our accreditation. We are a fully accredited high school. So congratulations. Thank you, Mr. Moore, for your efforts. Students, congratulations. A couple of other items with regard to the high school project. We certainly remain committed to including the last purchase of technology within the project. I discussed this last night at the building committee meeting. As the project winds down, the building committee is reviewing the budget and remaining contingencies. This technology is a part of the Wethersfield High School student instructional program, and I certainly hope that it will be funded. On January 30th, many of you, along with myself and Mr. Kazaka, met with folks from the town as well as Bloom Shapiro to go over our annual audit. Very pleased to inform you that the auditors reported no findings for the Wethersfield Board of Education. One area that they asked that we continue to focus on includes refining our policies and procedures manual that we currently have in place in our business office. Just a reminder that Friday is a district PD day. There will be no school for students. Sorry about that, students. The winter recess will occur next Monday, where the district will be closed for President's Day, and students will also have Tuesday off as well. So, and then finally, last but not least, certainly many of you are probably aware of the fact that the governor proposed his budget last Wednesday, and for us it's provided many questions, many more questions than answers at this point in time. It certainly appears that on the surface, Wethersfield will be receiving additional funding. However, there are many questions that need to be answered related to the special education fund, the contribution to teacher retirement, as well as the ECS numbers. We also expect that the governor's budget will likely undergo many changes before the end of the fiscal year in June, and this timing presents a difficult challenge, as the town and board budgets must be set by May 15th. So this evening, I'll be presenting the superintendent's proposed budget for 17-18. And again, that does not take into account the aspects of the governor's budget, as it is all in draft form at this point in time. So with that, that's communications.
Okay, thank you. All right, under reports and discussions tonight, the first item is Policy and Planning Committee has met on September 21st, 2016, and January 4th, 2017, to review and discuss the 3000 series. The committee approved forwarding these policies to the full board as a first reading, with the exception that a final action will be taken on the board's next regular meeting on February 28, 2017. So I'm looking for any comments from our board members. Anyone? Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I was out of order. Thank you. I'm out of order. We're moving on to our action items. Thank you. And Polly, would you please read our motion 6A for us?
Madam Chair, we have a motion in regard to the MBR, and my recommendation would be that we table this pending additional information and also further consideration by the Finance Committee and the administration.
So that's that motion. Is there
second?
Is there any discussion?
Yes. This is an issue related to the maintenance of the minimum budget requirement in this year's current budget. As you know, at our budget workshop, we received a memo from the town with an option to address this minimum budget requirement. We received additional information from the town late this afternoon with them looking to go in a different direction. So I would recommend that this motion be tabled until we get additional information from the town.
Any other discussion? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? So this motion is tabled. Okay, we can move on, and I'll repeat myself. The Policy and Planning Committee met on September 21st, 2016, and January 4th, 2017, to review and discuss the 3000 series. The committee approved forwarding these policies to the full board as a first reading, with the exception that final action will be taken at the board's next regular meeting on February 28th, 2017. So I'm looking for any comments from board members on our 3000 series. Polly.
I would just like to indicate that there is an addendum to this packet just for you to review that has to do with some changes as regard to food services personnel. And so we have the Policy and Planning Committee is meeting tomorrow night, and this will be considered. And also there are other items, but I did want you to be just aware of that's what this item is that you just got on your in your place, and so you might want to look at it.
And that is a mandate too, right?
Yeah. Correct? If you have any questions, please let us know, or you're invited to the meeting if you'd like to.
What are you serving?
Any other comments, John?
I had noticed. I think there might be a mistake, and maybe we can discuss this tomorrow.
Sure.
On P3121, the sentence right after the shaded part. Reads like something that dropped out there if you read the sentence. any money remaining at the end, administrative policies and regulations. That doesn't, something's missing there. It doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, there are a couple of, I'm sorry, fell asleep.
Probably
on that
not
one.
The only one.
Yeah, I think we should look at that tomorrow, and maybe we can, then we can kind of decipher it a little bit, if you don't mind. And just, we did have a couple of questions from some board members after this was received. If anybody has anything additional that you'd like us to look at it for tomorrow night, please feel free. So hold that thought, though, would you please, John?
I'll be sure to remember it.
Yeah, would you?
Just fold the page.
Anyone else?
I just have one question. Polly, on 3450, it talks about our escrow account, and the board shall appoint a treasurer. And I found myself asking, who is the treasurer?
Actually, you know what? That's one of the things that I found that we're going to have to look at, because
okay.
According to my notes, okay. We had eliminated that paragraph. So we'd made some changes to that one. So we will address that tomorrow. Thanks, though.
And what grades wear ID badges? You talked about there are going to be ID badges. Identification badges will be provided for all employees and students. And I just wondered, well, how far down we go, Mike, with badges?
Down to grade 7.
Okay. Thanks.
Any other comments? Okay, so we'll take that back.
Yes,
and we'll,
we will.
Thank
we'll
you.
Work on it. Thank
Stay
you.
Stay tuned.
All right, also tonight, Mr. Emmett will be showing us a PowerPoint presentation on the proposed 2017-18 school year budget. Mr. Emmett.
Thank you. The moment we've all been waiting.
Well, it's that time of year again where we all gather around the Finance Committee and we start the arduous task of crafting a budget. This is one of the most challenging tasks that we have, quite frankly, here in town. The idea of appropriately and adequately funding our school system pays huge dividends, and failure to do so can certainly create a great deal of strife. As I stand before you this evening to present this budget, I have to tell you that I am extraordinarily proud of the progress we have made. I'm proud of the progress that the board has made in terms of providing clear and direct leadership, holding folks accountable, and focusing on kids first. And that's a pleasure to be able to work with the group that is so committed to our children. I'm also very pleased to report that the investment that we make in our children certainly pays off. It pays off with the state-of-the-art high school. It pays off with test scores that were among the highest in terms of rate of growth in the entire state of Connecticut. It talks about the extracurricular activities from theater programs to sports programs to our new technology. It talks about everything that we're about here in Wethersfield, and I think that picture sums it up. We started off this year with a public budget workshop on Saturday the 28th. This was an opportunity for me to provide you with a little bit of framework as to where we were heading this year. And again, I'll cut right to the chase. We're looking at a proposed budget for 17-18 of $58,277,882. This represents an increase of $1,664,782. An overall increase percentage-wise of 2.94%. What is this increase? Contractual obligations, benefit requirements, state and federal mandates, OPEB trust and pension, and then our fixed costs. One of my colleagues in a neighboring town presented his budget last night, and he talked about his budget being a status quo budget. That, quite frankly, is pretty much where we're at. The majority of, actually all of this increase is really based upon contractual increases in benefits. Here's the budget by object. Again, this is very similar to what you see in towns across the state. What you're looking at here is the percentage of salaries and benefits. It definitely makes up the majority of the budget. And here by major programs. Here's a slide that gives you an indication as to the percentage of our budget compared to the town. So our school budget represents 57.64% of the total budget here in town. This is an interesting slide as well. If you take a look from 12-13 to our proposed 17-18, you can see our year-over-year increase. Now you're asking, well, where did that huge drop come from? The $241,722 increase was a function of the fact that we had additional funds left in last year's budget that we applied to this year's budget. Hence, we had an increase of 0.42%. As you know, and you'll talk about it this evening when we talk about the Finance and Information Management Committee meeting, we have been running in a deficit over the course of this year. So we are not anticipating having any funding going back to the town at the conclusion of this fiscal year. Again, here's a comparison. This is the year-over-year budget increase between town and Board of Education. I want to talk with you about the requests that were not included in the budget, and this is the hard part. As a superintendent, where I have to strike that balance. I have to give our kids what they need. I have to give our teachers and our principals what they need. I also have to be responsible in a tough economic time to know that taxes continue to rise and the funding continues to dwindle. So it's really striking that balance. What we did over the course of the budget development time was we met with all of our principals and our department leaders, who in turn had met with teachers and curriculum specialists and liaisons, both at the middle and the high school level, and talked about aspects of items that we would need. And you can see here that we have many requests that did not make it in the budget. And I think it's important to publicize this because of the fact that we'd certainly like to get stronger, we'd certainly like to add staff, but we know we have to strike that balance. Again, what we did with our principals was we focused on priorities, and you see here some of the priorities. So at the high school level, the priority is the addition of a tutor. At the middle school, the top priority is the addition of social work time from 0.5 to 1.0. From a district level, that 1.0 ELL teacher. And at the elementary level, elementary principals have all concurred that we need additional special education support. And again, you see the priority there, the 0.5 social worker. One of the interesting pieces with this particular slide, you look at the second bullet, approximately $400,000 of building improvements. That is one of the aspects that we've utilized to get this budget down to where it is. Typically speaking, we would put in our budget the request for refurbishment of two classrooms at each school. That fell to the cutting room floor for this year, and it's off for next year's budget as well. Again, at this point in time, there is a strong interest in the lacrosse program at $50,000. We're going to need to think outside the box. $50,000 is for a full startup. We're going to need to go back with those folks and talk about how we started at a lower level. We started as a club, and we may need some support, quite frankly. And again, over $400,000 for technology equipment, including complete integration of one-to-one. We're getting close. We're making strides with regard to our technology, but ultimately we'd like to get to one-to-one status and really move toward a more paperless environment in our schools. So just as an overview, the unfunded requests, we were looking at about $1.73 million for additional requests, and we have none of those in this budget. This piece here with potential adjustments, this is always one of those to be determined, and that's the health insurance. I will tell you that we are fortunate here in Wethersfield that we have a health insurance increase of only 2%. And talking with some of my colleagues in surrounding towns, one town in particular had a budget increase of 4% alone just on health insurance. So we've been trending very favorably. We had one bargaining unit that was left to get into the HSA, and that bargaining unit actually, pending approval of their contract, is the last one that's going into HSA. So we'll have all of our employees in on the HSA at this point in time. And obviously, you know, 2016, we enjoyed a banner year in terms of low gas prices, so our diesel fuel was low. We're projecting a 50-cent increase per gallon at this point in time. These are our object areas, talking about salaries, talking about benefits, coaching stipends, and you'll notice overtime for maintenance, that's an area where we've reduced. Substitute secretary salaries, we've also reduced. We've tried to look at reductions that have the least impact on kids and instruction. And again, when you look at those personal services salaries, many of those are contractual increases. Here's the impact of the salary increases. One of the things I want to make you aware of also, as we see fewer and fewer dollars coming in through grant funding and from the state, what we'll need to do within this proposed budget is shifting a teacher, a 0.9 FTE of a teacher out of the IDEA grant. The IDEA grant is the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act grant. And in addition to the 0.9 teacher, we're looking to shift out two paraprofessionals. We've seen our IDEA funding decrease over the past 4 years, so this is the result. It's overall here, personal services for benefits, it's an increase of 7.41. The HSA distribution, there may be some of you that are wondering that 400% increase, that HSA distribution is a distribution that is effective of our Wethersfield Federation of Teachers moving over to the HSA. One of the things we did with our negotiations with the teachers is we offered up a 1 year, which would have been this year, a PPO buy-up option for those teachers that wanted to maintain coverage in the PPO for an additional year. They cover the cost of the difference. We didn't have any teachers that took advantage of that. Everybody moved over into the HSA. So that's a figure that will not trend upward next year. That will trend downward. Again, we're very fortunate with regard to our health insurance. The health insurance is decreasing a total of 11.47% due to lower premium costs of the high deductible plan. So that is paying off. Also want to make sure that you're aware of the fact that the OPEB contribution, that is our share. We contribute to OPEB as well as the town, and we have a percentage of that, and that is set with the town. Here's where you start to see the decreases that get us down to the 294 that we're at. So you're seeing a total of a 2.55% decrease in this line. Again, this decrease of 0.37% is based on deferring facility repairs. That's dangerous, quite frankly, when you look at our elementary schools. They're a little on the tired side, and they do need to be repaired. So this is a gamble that we're certainly going to be taking. There's no doubt about that. This is my fifth budget that I've presented. I have not had a budget that's had so many red numbers in it. I could tell you that. Again, we're looking at a reduction. This is an expectation that we are reducing special education outplacements. We're also looking in terms of a revenue source. Our Transition Academy is up and running. We had our first tuition bearing student this year. We are marketing that program, and hopefully we'll be able to bring in a couple of additional tuitions, which would raise some revenue. And again, we looked at areas where we could decrease instructional supplies, books and periodicals. I want to bring your point your attention to electricity. With our current budget right now, we are almost $60,000 above last year's year-over-year cost for electricity in the district. So you'll notice a rather robust 13.45% increase in electricity. That's based on this year's trending. I think that there was the belief that the high school project with all the LED and the efficient lighting would drastically reduce the energy costs. That has not been the case. While we have lots of efficient lighting, we're using that building all the time. So that's the offset there. And again, this is what I spoke to earlier in terms of decreasing various classroom furniture requests and replacement of technology. And then our dues and fees are down a little bit. So in terms of the budget outcomes, you know, we remain committed to providing a high-quality education for our students. I think we've demonstrated that. We certainly remain focused on continuous improvement and adhering to state and federal mandates. I will tell you, as your superintendent, with the reduction in the funding coming from the state, we've also asked for mandate relief. We spend a lot of money on mandates to the state of Connecticut, and my feeling is if we're going to see reductions in municipal allocations, we need to see a reduction in mandates. We certainly wish to build upon the progress we've made, no two ways about that. We wish to maintain our commitment to learning for all of our students. That is evidenced by the work you're doing with our strategic plan right now. And then the other idea here is we're looking to foster innovation throughout the district. In spite of the fact that the times are tough, we cannot rest on our laurels and we cannot stop innovating. We cannot stop thinking ahead. So we have a lot of work to do here at this point in time. The timeline at this point, we've had one budget workshop already. In addition to that, all board members have been out to PTOs to share the message about the budget. My budget presentation happens this evening, obviously. We will look to take action on this budget on the 28th of February at our next regularly scheduled board meeting. We then must forward our budget to the town hall by the 15th of March. At that point in time, I would imagine we would present the budget before town council. That usually happens at some point in the latter part of March. And then we have our townwide budget hearing. That's Monday, the 17th of April, right here in council chambers. And then finally, last but not least, the allocation of the budget funds happens by May 15th of 2017. And again, please note, we don't know for sure what the state budget's going to look like. That'll be settled long after we're finished. So there is certainly some uncertainty. But at this point in time, I'd certainly entertain any questions you have. Hey, you want to come up too?
Anyone? Polly?
I'm looking at the page. It must be 15. On the overtime for custodial. Excuse me. The custodial general. I'm sorry. Last year, we had asked for, and I believe we were able to put into our budget last year an additional custodian for the high school.
That's
Am I correct?
Yes.
I'm seeing here that what we have for budgeted for overtime for the coming year is 80,000. Is that, can that, if we were to look at some point to hiring an additional custodian, would that, and does that help us out with the overtime at all, or is this mainly because of the fact that we've got the schools open at so many various times that aren't actual work days?
Yeah, this really, thanks for the question, Polly. This really is kind of part and parcel to the fact that we need custodians on over the course of the weekend. So, for example, this past month, I know February 5th was a Sunday. There was a major swim event at the high school, and I think the building use form went from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. Last Sunday, we had the wrestling, Wethersfield Wrestling Club in, was an all-day event. So we have custodial on. When we have outside venues, outside folks in, or let's say park and rec department, when park and rec department comes in, we put a custodian on. The park and rec department provides the board with a total of $20,000 over the course of the year as kind of a stipend for custodial and use of the buildings. That's an avenue that we need to kind of take a look at, because one has to ask the question, is $20,000 covering all of the overtime we're providing as well as the electricity costs? With the electricity in that particular analysis, we're asking Eversource to provide us with numbers as to what happens on the scope of the weekend. How frequently do we have the buildings open, and mm-hmm. what is the financial impact? So that may be something we need to look at. I think the other piece we need to look at also is if we have outside groups coming in, we as a board, you as a board, set the policy with regard to building use fees. We continue to get groups that will want to come in and want us to waive the fees, and I don't think we're in a position right now where we can do that.
So if we were to, if we look at this $80,000, and then actually that $2,000 below that for when we're talking about facilities rental, so that would also encompass when we have. You know, when we're using the buildings for extra school activities, like we're renting the, we're allowing Parks and Recs or the wrestling club or whatever. So if we want to try to get a handle on what those costs are, mm-hmm. then this is where this would fall. Along with the information that we'll be able to get from the Eversource analysis, mm-hmm. so that we'll be able to establish a little bit of a handle on it,
yes.
and look at our fees from there.
Yes.
Okay. Great. Go ahead.
Was there an increase in custodial overtime due to the high school renovation, us having to have somebody there on site? Why? They're working late to the night or on weekends and so forth.
Yes, Diane, that's correct. We typically had a custodian on to monitor the building. At the point of construction over the past summer, we didn't have the Sonatrol system, so we did not have an alarmed building at that point. So we absolutely had somebody on. The other piece
have we taken that into consideration for budgeting purposes this year, that we are not going to incur that expense?
Mm-hmm. Other areas that we might incur that overtime expense would be if we had an issue with a building. Let me give you some examples. 2 years ago, right before school opened, we had a valve on an eye wash, a chemical eye wash, in one of our science classrooms at Silas Dean fail. It poured water all over, like, three floors. It came out the front side of the building. That was an all-hands-on-deck where every maintenance guy came in on a weekend, and that in and of itself would be one of those big ticket overtime items. Several years back, we had the epic snowstorms. We actually had our custodians up on the roofs. The fire department helped us out with getting snowblowers up on the roofs. That's another overtime aspect. So it's really across the district. This year, we had an issue with a pipe breaking in the wall over at Highcrest, and that had to be done over the scope of the weekend. So that's another overtime factor. So go ahead, Diane.
I have a couple questions.
Sure.
Underneath, you have overtime custodial facilities rental overtime of $2,000. But from what you're saying, some of those costs are in the line item overtime custodial general. Mm-hmm. $2,000 seems pretty low.
Mm-hmm. That's net of the revenue we take in from the outside.
Okay, so it's a net. Okay. And then on that same page, on page 15 as well, The curricular stipends, that has like a 32% increase. Why is that so high?
The current year budget, unfortunately, omitted the high school fall and spring production. When we transitioned from the old chart of accounts to the new, there were unfortunately a few items that were missed into the 16-17 budget. So now they are in 17-18, creating that large increase.
Okay. And then I think this is the last one. On the next page on 17, the defined benefit, that has a 150, almost 160% increase.
Mm, and that's skewed as well due to the prior year surplus, $500,000. So really that line should be about an $800,000 to the current increase, which really is about a 10% increase year over year.
Okay. That's all I have.
Okay. Anyone else?
Oh, I just wanted to ask one more. I see that under the employee education reimbursement, that has been increased to $60,000. Are you finding that that our staff is taking advantage of that of those available funds?
You are? Absolutely. Over the past 2 years, we've exhausted that fund. We had a time period probably 4 or 5 years back where we had money left in that line.
Well, that was why I was wondering. So I'm glad to see that.
We have numerous teachers. Matter of fact, tomorrow we have an administrative team meeting. I have two, a guidance counselor and a math teacher, who are currently pursuing their 092 degrees to become administrators. So they'll be joining us. So you have those folks, people going back to get master's degrees. So we like that. I mean, that's obviously, that's continued learning.
Oh, good. Okay.
John?
Thank you. Just an observation, you know, and it wasn't mentioned in your presentation, but the requests not included in the budget aren't new. These requests have been in this budget year after year after year. So it just seems as if, you know, we continually, you know, prolong what is eventually going to happen. We need to get them. And we understand, and the board really appreciates the creative ability to get our budget moving. But I just want the public to understand that when they do get a document like this, these aren't new ideas. They've been in past budgets. Mm-hmm. So,
could I just follow up on that? And they're not what I would consider to be initiatives. They're, you know, what we're, these items that have been requested, and as Mr. Cassia said, you know, over the last few years, are not necessarily something that's new and inventive. These are, again, basically we're kicking the can down the road. So at some point, we are going to have to, even if we chip away at them, look at, you know, keep them in the forefront, because this is, like, as with our maintenance and facilities, it's, there are, that's a space, or even technology, it's a spot where we can perhaps cut it, because they're easy, they seem like easy targets, but they're not going to be, we're not going to be able to do that forever.
Well, I think the thing to remember here, and you both bring up very good points, the requests that we have are really based on need, and they're based on analysis. So let me take, for example, the English language learner teacher. That's one that's been on the list before. We've seen a burgeoning population of English language learners coming into Wethersfield, speaking a variety of different languages. I mentioned in my Friday update last week, I had the opportunity to go over and visit adult ed at the high school. And I went into a beginner's ESL class for adults. And we had residents there from Syria, Bangladesh, Vietnam, Puerto Rico, Peru, Bosnia, Albania. I mean, we really represent the world. And when you look at the numbers and how our numbers have continued to climb, I have two ELL teachers for the entire district. And it's just that the talent is being spread too thin. You look at the issue of, you know, the principal's request for an additional special ed teacher with a focus on reading instruction. We are seeing our numbers for special education continue to rise. So that's something that we need to make sure that we're at the forefront of. We're providing all of our students with the specialized instruction that they're entitled to. At the middle school level, you know, we deal with on a daily basis, students that are in crisis. Having that social worker there even half time is critical. But to be able to have that individual there directly servicing kids, that's a priority for Ms. Zaplin. We want to certainly try and address that, which is one of the reasons why I think it's critically important as we move forward. You know, the task tends to be with this budget is we start off at 294, and then we chip away, and we chip away, and we chip away. We knock it down, we knock it down, we knock it down. I'm of the mindset that if we're able to be able to find any savings between now and the end of the year, that we be able to reinvest it in that ELL teacher. You know, not asking the town for more, but, you know, rather than just giving. Again, I think we've demonstrated results over the past year, and I think that we're getting the return on our investment.
I heard technology mentioned. Can you tell the public, I know the board knows, the plan to be one-to-one and as soon as we can? That really is a 21st century school system.
Absolutely. Well, I said this last night at the building committee meeting. I think the perception of technology has long been that it's one of those nice-to-haves, and it's a supplement. Every school that I go into, I see kids working with technology. So technology has moved from a nice-to-have to a have-to-have. Going to Emerson Williams School, I go by a sixth grade class and they are engaged using the Chromebooks. Going into the high school, I can go into the media center. Everybody is on the computers. Mr. Breton, a couple of months ago, music theory.
Right.
Yes. You know, a nice brand new iMac, and Mr. Rio is teaching and they're engaged and they're on the technology. So we use it. The kids use it. It's the way kids learn. And when we look at it, you know, the days of, you know, the textbook and bringing home 20 textbooks, we're shifting away from that. It's a long process. It's not going to be easy. And you'll learn this as we move forward toward a more paperless Board of Education. Now that we've gotten iPads back from the building committee, those will be redirected out to you so that your packets will now be electronic. It'll be nice because it saves us money on paper and it saves the cost and wear and tear of the courier as well. So we're always trying to move in that direction. So we know that there are limitations. And again, within this particular budget, there is money in there for a lease of equipment. We did no lease at all last year. So we're starting to fall behind and we need to maintain that trajectory forward.
Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else for comments? Kevin.
Thank you. You had mentioned, and we had discussed previously, that almost all 100% of this, of the increase, is contractually obligated, mm-hmm. 98 or something percent. You know, if, you know, once this moves over to the council, there's, you know, there's no fat left on the bone here, as we mentioned, I mean, and they deem it necessary to have a decrease, I mean, what are the, I mean, if you could relate to the public, what are the alternatives that we're looking at here?
Well, it's people. That's the bottom line. And I mean, I'm not trying to scare anybody. I'm not trying to create any type of a problem here. But the reality is it's people. You know, if you're talking about a 1% reduction to this budget, it's going to be staff. I have no other where to cut. We've cut already. You know, this budget, 104, I think it was, what, 104% of this budget is salaries and benefits. So we've reduced everywhere else we can reduce at this point in time. You know, my hope certainly is that we maintain all of our staff. We maintain all of our programs. You have said as a board that you want low class sizes. I hear that loud and clear. So all of our teachers remain in the positions that they're in. But if we're looking at significant reductions to this budget, we are going to be looking at people. And that's one of the difficult tasks that we will have to look at in terms of how that plays out. I look at it from a perspective of we've invested, as we've seen some of our teachers retire, we've invested in some really innovative staff. Every week you now get the Blue Eagle News. I mean, that is just amazing, the work that they're doing over at that high school. And that happens to be coming from one of our teachers that we just brought aboard. So the impact is certainly huge. I would also say that it's not just the conversation here in Wethersfield. It's really in many municipalities across the state.
Okay. All set?
Okay. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Matt. Okay, we'll move on to Board of Education meetings that were held and reports on them. The first one is shared services on January 11, 2017, and the committee met in the town manager's conference room. Mr. Emmett, John Cassio, Polly, and I were present for the board. The committee is looking into what services the town and the Board of Ed can share for better service, efficiency, and perhaps cost savings. We listened to Keith Raffinello give a report on the status of the combined technology services that are now in place. And Keith gave a recent example of utilizing the newly combined expertise and equipment for the police department's memorial services for Thor, the police dog who died from injuries in the line of duty. Keith complimented the ease of the problem solving to get what the police and the community wanted. The committee will continue to search for services that could be combined and for other towns that may have already combined certain departments with success in their communities. We also had facilities and maintenance committee. And John, would you talk about that?
Absolutely. We had a facilities and maintenance committee meeting on Thursday, January 12th. In attendance from the board, Janet Vassell, myself, Bobby, and Elaine, along with our superintendent and Fred Bushy, facilities and maintenance. The agenda was, I think, a great discussion. We started with the NESDEC study and the next steps, and that of which it allowed the superintendent to reach out to another district to see how things are going. We currently did the enrollment. Now we're going to be doing the facilities and basically looking at it, the next steps for our facilities per school, what we're going to do and how we're going to do it. And it's just, you know, something that the community at large is going to have to do and look at for the possibility of upcoming renovations of our elementary schools at this point. So we've got an eye on it, we're looking at it, and it's not something that we're trying to happen. And so that's where we are with the facilities and maintenance at this point.
Thanks, John. We have the CREC Council, which was on January 18th, and the Capital Region Education Council consists of 35 towns, and Wethersfield has a seat on this council. They recently rewarded their mission statement and vision goals and objectives, so they have a new strategic plan. This was presented to the council on that Wednesday. Their mission is to work with boards of ed of the Capital Region to improve the quality of public education for all learners. Because of the state budget concerns, CREC too faces challenges, but also, as they see it, opportunities. Their new strategic plan focuses on building a culture of working with the region and not pitting CREC against the towns it serves. They want to be the education service center for the Capital Region. I always look forward to the comments of Patrice McCarthy, who's an attorney for CABE and a liaison to the legislature. Her comments and discussions were focused on unfunded mandates, how they affect town school systems, budgets, and what we can do to rework this legislative setup. Mr. Emmett, myself, and Polly went to the legislative breakfast on Thursday, January 26th in the morning, to talk to our legislatures about these unfunded mandates and other concerns. And as I always say, there's lots of questions and very few answers. We also had a special Board of Education meeting. John and I seem to be tag-teaming it right now. But we had a retreat on January 25th, 2017. And this is when the board met, and we have met in this retreat model with Lyle Kirkman, who's an author on leadership competencies and whole system change. Lyle is working with the administration and the board to achieve simplicity and focus in our work. The simplicity is achieved through a leadership model, and the focus, of course, is student learning and is in the forefront of our minds all the time. Innovation is a key to results for any district, so we must try new approaches to reaching our students, gaining community support, and engaging our staff. Therefore, the board is working through a steering committee to create a strategic plan. I'm co-chair of the steering committee. Will inform you of our efforts thus far. John?
Johnny and Bobby, here we go. All righty, we did meet on the 25th. The board was present, and basically what we're looking at is a mission and vision of the Wethersfield Board of Ed. The unique thing about this is we as a board, in the history that I've served, have really never gotten in such deep discussion as to the next steps of Wethersfield Board of Education and the public schools. So this, as we move forward and look and dive into the mission and vision discussion, we'll look into some strategic planning and the process and the timeline. At this point, board members have submitted some information that we will put together and review as the leadership team and then bring it forward to the entire board. Our goal is to complete this hopefully by May, this school year, and hopefully have it out and move it to the table. We will be involving not only the board, administrators, faculty, staff, but we will also have a component of the community and parents and students. Jack?
Thank you, John, but you're still on.
Oh, we're going to march in the parade.
Yeah, go right to the parade.
We're marching in a parade next. All right, mark your calendars. The Memorial Day Parade is going to be May 27th, Saturday. And the lineup will be, as always, we're going to have a great day. Motor Vehicle Department, and start there and follow the same parade route, which goes down Garden to, what's that street? That street. Main's down to Main Church. Street. Yeah, Church to Main to the green.
First time in town, John?
Yeah, it is. The maze is going. The snow got to me. And the parade marshal and the theme have not been taken care of yet. The school board, through Sally DeStoli, has reached out to the middle school students for the essay contest. And we've got some ideas for next year, but this year we're going to keep it the same question. What does Memorial Day mean to you? Next year we have some different thoughts and suggestions just to change things up, to move forward in the parade. And every year we've had great weather and a great turnout, so mark your calendars and we'll see you on the 27th of May. Okay. There won't be any snow on the ground.
Thank you. Thank you, John. We had a special Board of Ed meeting for the budget on January 28th. Polly, will you speak to it?
Sure. You have the minutes that we approved today are in your packet. We basically all got together and we had, I thought, a very robust discussion, if you will, around what we're facing for budget next year, which, as you just saw tonight, is a little on the grim side, but at least we were able to have some good discussion, and that was very helpful. That's pretty. We were very fortunate. I was pleased to see that we did have several members of town council, and also some members of the public who attended. So, and as well as just about all of our administrators were there, which we always appreciate that, and they gave us a lot of input. So it was a great first step. Thank you.
Thanks, Polly. So we have a joint Town Council Board of Education Finance Committee, and that was on January 30th. Michael, you want to speak to it?
Sure. This, I had mentioned this earlier during communications. This was the meeting where we got together with folks from the town side and met with two of our auditors from Bloom Shapiro to review the annual audit report. As I mentioned during communications, the board finances were found to be in good Stead at this point in time. They did make mention of the fact that we can continue to work on our policies and procedures manual. That is in place through a previous audit. That was something that we needed to do. Matt has that in place. They also made mention of outstanding checks, and that's already been in place as well. So we're in pretty good shape. Very pleased to say.
Great. Thank you. Wethersfield Early Childhood Collaborative Committee, or WEC, met just yesterday. Matt?
Sure. Two major updates, both pretty exciting, actually. We got the first view of the beta test of the Virtual Family Resource Center, which is, I think, something that our town has really sort of wanted for a long time. Mm-hmm. This is going to be a virtual area where all kinds of families, or all families, can get information about all the resources for Connecticut. So it's like a one-stop shop for all kinds of great stuff. You have kids, and you want to know what kind of daycare facilities, like all of them are around, and how much they cost, here's the place to go. You want your kids to be involved with sports, here's where you can find all this stuff. You want to get social help for all kinds of things, from mental illness to food stamps to all kinds of stuff, here's where you go to get it. And we saw the beta test, or a portion of the beta test, made some comments, and it's up and it's in progress. It's not up and going yet, but it's getting there. So this is pretty cool. It's going to really help all of our families out. It'll be a one-stop shop. They talk about volunteer opportunities. You can put on a list there, and community calendars, and it's. I don't want to oversell it, but I think it's a really great
good
thing.
Commercial.
And they're doing it, which is great. So second thing, People Empowering People was something we talked about 2 months ago. It is an intense program to create community leaders. 12 people are in the group. The classes are going on right now. And hopefully in a few months, or we will in a few months, have 12 new community leaders that are going to be out there making our town better. And that's fantastic.
Thank you. Thanks, Matt. Community and Public Relations Committee, we had that yesterday too. Kevin?
Yes, thank you. We did meet yesterday in the superintendent's conference room. First, we discussed the kind of the official high school ribbon cutting ceremony. There's no date set for that. Yeah, it'll be sometime in April, hopefully during the week, in the evening. This will be more of a formal program where dignitaries and the such can be invited, where you can recognize volunteers, building committee, that kind of thing. And as John mentioned, we discussed our mission and vision statement that we've been working on and kind of best how to outreach not only to students and teachers and administrators, but PTOs, parents, businesses, chambers of commerce, get as many people involved as we possibly can. And we also discussed the utilizing the high school and its multimedia audiovisual capabilities that it has. We'll have our next meeting hopefully at the high school where we can invite Sue Coco and the AV Club perhaps and see what they have to offer.
Great. Thank you, Kevin. School Projects Building Committee, same night. Michael?
Yes, after Community and Public Relations, I snuck down to the Building Committee and caught the tail end of that. The Building Committee really at this point in time is at the point where they're beginning to wrap things up. We're looking at what budgets look like, what's left in contingency. I did get an understanding last evening that some of the residents around Wethersfield High School that have been concerned over the visual of looking at the HVAC units. There was a meeting that happened last week with members of the Building Committee as well as planning and zoning and residents, and there will be a solution of partial screening as well as landscaping. I don't have any details on that at this point in time, but I'll certainly share them as soon as I get them.
Okay, thank you.
Can I just ask one question? One of the issues also which was brought up by the residents that were around the high school had to do with noise from the generators that were on top of the building. Is that screening going to help with that at all? Was there any mention made of it last night or not?
Polly, unfortunately, I got there late, so okay. I didn't see any of the schematics or any of the layout.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
So I'll have to get that information for you.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, and last on our meetings held, Finance and Information Management Committee, we just left. Polly?
Yes, thank you. As Mr. Emmett mentioned previously in his presentation, we are still running a forecast deficit, However, at this particular point, it's as opposed to last year, which was, or last month, which was about 245,000. We are looking at the projection of 118,636. This includes, and the majority of it is really because of the fact that there have been there's been up to $150,000 in anticipated savings, and they through deferring maintenance projects, the tech department holdbacks, and there's been a reduction in some of the non-essential, non-instructional equipment, and also a freeze on general purchasing. So if obviously these are things that hope, you know, at some point should our we find that there are other savings in other places that can help to offset it, then sort of hopefully the budget freeze can be lifted and we can address some of these other issues. As Mr. Emmett also mentioned, a lot of this is of our over or our deficit is due to the the electricity budget, which is now up over $50,000 in surplus. So, as far as an overage is concerned, and the other thing is that the we have a the committee and based on actually action by the board, an RFP has been developed to send out for transportation to specifically our bus company. So Mr. Kazaka is putting the final touches on that. That should go out probably within the next couple of weeks, and we will start some interviewing and that type of thing in April when they all come back. So I would also just like to make one comment. There were a number of us who attended that meeting with the finance committee for the town, and for Blum Shapiro's report on the audit. And I would just like to say that because of the fact that, well, this is my fifth of these, I think, I would like to say that I was really proud of the fact that that we had such good feedback as far as the fact that we addressed issues that had been brought up in previous management letters, and we did have such a positive management letter that came back, and also very positive reaction from the auditors as far as they're working with the business office and the staff there and the availability information and that type of thing, and it was really nice. So I thank everyone who was involved with that, because I know it's a tough thing when it's happening. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Polly. Okay, meeting scheduled. We have a CREC Council meeting tomorrow, 2:15 at 11:30. Policy and Planning Committee tomorrow at 5:30. Student Program and Services Committee on the 22nd at 6:30. And School Projects Building Committee on the 27th at 6:30. Okay. Is there any unfinished business? We're all set? Okay. Anyone wishing to make a public comment, please come on up to the podium and state your name and address. And can I remind you that we have a 5-minute limit? Okay. Are there any board comments? Talked a lot tonight. John.
I had the opportunity, along with, went to Charles Wright Elementary School with Polly and discussed with them the budget and the concerns that we just saw tonight. And they have a great group of parents there working very hard, and they were very interested in how they could help. Also had the opportunity with Janet to go to the Silas Dean Middle School, and that was a big group of parents. Must be doing something good there. They had a lot going on, and a pretty healthy budget as not a budget, an agenda, pretty healthy agenda, moving it forward. So they're very interested in the budget, but a lot of the parents there seem to be overlapping with the elementary school, and they already heard it. So Janet and I did the skit. You missed out, Kevin. We tried to get you there, but it was good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Matthew?
On a similar note, John Morris and I went to Highcrest. Lots of support there. Lots of support for our budget. They asked many times, what dates can we go to support, education and so on and so forth. That probably to Mike, that probably should be something we should tell the PTOs and PTAs, when, public input is what their opportunities are. When is our opportunity to talk about these things? And that's information that they certainly wanted. But I think that one of the things, and this is sort of an ongoing trend, and I'm so happy that, I am happy, but I'm really pleased to hear from John Cassio regarding facilities and services, because as we've talked about, and I've been taking an active role to get into the schools, talk, and really find out, what's going on. But it's very plain to me that our elementary schools are more than tired. They're in many cases in rough shape. And I think that there's the reality that really struck me, and John can maybe speak to this or not, is that when we were at Highcrest, when we talked about the budget, the first things that talked about was the school, the structure. The leaking roofs, the buckets on the floor for months, and the principal that was there, she within 20 feet from here, from me to Jack, would tell me about six problems from me to Jack along the corridor. The skylight, the here, the closet there. The fact that because now we have increased security, which is of course a good thing, but now the doors can't be opened, and that school is designed for a cross breeze situation, like it was architecturally designed that way. So now they're, say we could use some air conditioning like in some certain areas because we can't open the windows and we can't open the doors. There was dirty. There was a smell of urine from the bathrooms. I mean, because certain things have been disabled, so now the janitors have to go and not to get really gross about it, do various cleaning concepts that were not done before.
They're cleaning green.
It's more than that. So we need to tackle our elementary schools sooner rather than later. This is something that we need to do now. It's something that we need to acknowledge, to face, and in that, it's something that I can't express enough how much we need to really start to plan for the future of our elementary schools. And of course, it's the next group of schools to come after the middle school and the high school. In association with that, I'd also like to ask the superintendent that we continue the discussion about the pre-K-3, pre-K-4 programs, which is something that I've certainly talked about from this particular seat, but it's so important to getting our kindergarteners ready to climb the mountain. And I'd like to continue that dialogue, especially as John and his group looks at facilities, space needs, and so on and so forth. They're going to be two pieces that are married to each other. Concepts strategically goes along with a lot of what we talked about today, but it's a piece that I think we want to be ready for as some of these other decisions are being made, so we make thoughtful decisions moving forward.
Matt, if it helps you, we did discuss.
Yep.
We did discuss what you're talking about right now. So we hear you, and we're not, we're putting everything into motion that we can.
I said I was pleased. That's great. Yeah, thanks.
Anyone else? Okay, a few thoughts. First, and it's a few weeks ago now, but the Hartford Courant had recently been running stories concerning evaluation of superintendents. For our town citizens, I want you to know that the board did evaluate Mr. Emmett last year. He had written goals. The board used the teacher's evaluation rubric to score his goals. And Chris Hoffman, who was then a reporter for the Courant, asked me for the document, and it was sent to him. So it is FOI available. And on the same note, as we're talking about this, Matt Forrest, who's chair of the PD Special Advisory Committee, he and I went out to watch the new PD model, and we did get to see the buildings as it's being implemented in all the elementary schools. We were very pleased with how the teacher leaders, the curriculum specialists, were coaching teachers in their rooms during lessons and working with them individually to implement new units of curriculum. I know it was one of my favorite days because I was back in the classroom. And I want to tell everybody the assurance that these visits, there is great work being done out in those schools. I know we constantly talk about money because of the concerns, but there's so much being done in our schools that is fabulous work. So from there, Jack, any comments on life in your school?
Yeah, I just wanted to take a moment to recognize some fellow students who are on the JETS engineering design team. They recently placed within the top five in the country for their assistive technology design for persons with disabilities in the workplace. Really great program, really smart people that are doing it, and it's a great opportunity they're going to have. Also, the Blue Eagle News that Mr. Emmett discussed earlier is a great new thing that we're doing. It's very informative. You know, every Wednesday and Friday, I know many people look forward to it, and it's very well done and well produced. So, I look forward to seeing more from that in the future.
What about the spring production?
Spring production? Yeah, that will be March 9th through 11th. Shows of Sister Act, the musical.
Are you in it?
No, I'm not in it.
No,
I'm in the pit. Yeah.
There's quite a few performances too. There's like five performances of Sister Act. Mm.
Could I just follow up on that? Mm-hmm. One of the things on Friday, we had the monthly hunger action team meeting, and it was at the high school, which is great because we were able to meet in the conference room for our meeting, and then we joined some of the students when they were dismissed after 2 o'clock. And when you mentioned Sister Act, that reminded me that one of the people who's involved in the production had Jocelyn. Yeah.
Yes.
Came in and they gave us some great ideas, and the kids who are working on that show are coming up with ideas of how to possibly intersperse some food donations to our food bank into the production. I guess there is an area, a time in the second act when people there are contributions or donations that are made, and so what they're doing is trying to work out how they can get the community involved with the actual production, and also to include donations for the food bank at the production. So that was one of the great student ideas. So we can look forward to that as well. So it sounds like it's going to be great.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. May I have a motion to move to executive session for the purpose of contract discussions and possible ratification of the SEIU Local 2001 CSEA CTW Custodial Maintenance.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstentions? So that concludes the public part of our board meeting. Thank you all for coming and for watching. Good night.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Oh, thank you.
Yeah, unless that's